Praful and myself represent two radical ends of Indian academia, and we succeeded in getting our respective degrees without being detected, without our affiliations getting exposed. So that itself is an achievement, and I would like all of you to really applaud us for that. So, Sushant ji said that he's not an expert in politics, but I think in India you don't need to be an expert in politics. Even non-experts also are active political practitioners. And the other is, the titles that you read out, it sounds very good, but in the presence of those who have actually made us what we are today, I think these titles can be done away with. So I really want to thank the core committee of Prabuddha Bharat, Chaitanya ji, Lakshmikant ji, dear friend Sachin ji, and all the others for really discovering me somewhere and inviting me for this fantastic gathering. I think it is an unprecedented scene that we, those of us who are in Delhi, get to see. In Delhi, not only the physical atmosphere, but the intellectual atmosphere also is quite stagnating at times. And it is only the Luton's caucus which controls the intellectual discourse in Delhi, though that caucus is also now gradually breaking apart. So I'm really greatly honored, delighted, moved, and inspired to be here. And I once again thank you so much for inviting me. And obviously the added bonus and pleasure was, the added bonus, the intellectual feast was to listen to Mananiya Sri Dattaji, and that too on his birthday here. Because listening to him once pushes us again for the next 6 months into the journey of self-recovery, intellectual, cultural, and spiritual self-recovery. And I think that is all, that is what Prabuddha Bharat is all about. Intellectuals with social responsibility. Now, the contemporary challenge in the march of democracy, in the journey of democracy in India, are many. But primarily that challenge comes from two quarters. And these two quarters are interlinked. The intellectual buddhijivi, intellectual without social responsibility, is a challenge to the journey of democracy in India. It is the intellectual without any social responsibility who generates false narratives. And one of the strongest or one of the staunchest challenges to the well-being and journey of democracy in India is the false narrative. And therefore, as our national security advisor, Mr. Doval, very rightly said, while delivering the Sardar Patel Memorial Oration, beware of the false narrative. It is this false narrative which tells you that Kashmir is falling apart, that there is a tremendous oppression which is being undertaken by an occupational Indian army. It is a false narrative. And it is these intellectuals without any social responsibility. One of the best examples is the erstwhile members of the National Advisory Council who were never elected, but who wielded extraordinary, extra-constitutional power on policy making between 2004 and 2014. It is these intellectuals who are also impediments in our effort to reclaim the rightful dignity of Bharat. So therefore, I want to give a statutory warning. I think we must all be alert to the dangers of the intellectual without social responsibility. And of course, very rightly pointed out by Maniya Dattaji, intellectuals who have mortgaged their intellect, and we'll come to that. It is these who have actually been the dangers to the growth, to the establishment, to the perpetuation of democracy in India. Let's start with the journey. I'm sorry, I'll just finish that off with one sentence because I'm not qualified. You see, the problem is eminent historians, quote unquote, can speak on everything. But they will ask you not to speak on everything. Eminent historians can be card-carrying members of a particular political party. But when you open your mouth, they'll say, no, you belong to that political party or you belong to the RSS. So don't speak, you're not a historian. So therefore, what I will do is, I'll just stick to, in one sentence, I'll say, yes, obviously, the journey of democracy in India has been much longer than any other Western society or any other civilization for that matter. And I think I would recommend to all of you to read Swami Abhedananda's book, India and Her People, which was proscribed by the British government. These contained his collection of his speeches that he delivered in New York in Brookline. And where he actually talks about how Indian society had evolved perfect systems of governance long before the Europeans ever knew of it. And at a time when the Europeans were, he said, jumping from branch to branch or wearing tree bark at dresses. So I'll just end with that because I don't want to get into history because obviously we can't base ourselves continuously and wholly on past greatness, as has been rightly pointed out. So let me start with the challenge in 1947. So obviously, integration of Indian states by Sardar Patel, because I'm not getting into details. What I'm doing is I'm taking a tour d'horizon. I'll just go skim through, you know, go above, because this is an extremely informed audience, and I don't want to tax your patience by getting into too much detail about which you already know. So, integration of Indian states. The concept of establishing that we are now, re-establishing that we are now a physically united entity. Handling of the minorities post-independence. Because ironically, a large number of those who propagated the need for Pakistan stayed back in India. And so naturally, how would one handle them? How would one really mainstream them into a democratic polity? So there's this famous discussion which took place between Sardar Patel and Jawaharlal Nehru. There were many who wanted to come back after having gone. And Nehru wanted special places designated for them. Sardar Patel opposed it, saying, no, there will be no further ghettoization of a certain community in a free India. That community has to learn to live in harmony with the greater majority. Then, of course, there were administrative challenges. Administrative challenges in terms of one, establishing norms of governance, the governance structure, the idea that we are a federal polity, that powers and responsibilities had to be divided between a union and the states, and at the same time ensured that we do not turn into a confederation of states, that we continue remaining a federal polity with an essential fundamental unity, political, cultural, and economic, defining us. So these were the challenges. In fact, if one reads Maniben Patel's diaries and notes, she says that one of the main issues that worried Sardar Patel was food security. In a democratic India, in a smooth journey of democracy, you had to ensure basic thing as food security. in order to avoid food riots, in order to avoid conflicts. It's good that after 7 decades, we are again talking about toilets. We are talking about electricity, such basic things as roads, power. So this was one aspect, the administrative structure, the challenges, the administrative challenges. But post-independence, there was a formidable challenge which appeared in the horizon. And many of us lose track of that challenge. And that challenge was the communist revolt. They said, "Ye azadi jhoota hai." It's not a true revolution because there has been no class conflict. And so the Telangana revolution started, and you had communists who started organizing themselves, revolting against the newly established fledgling Republic of India. I think the first formidable challenge to democracy's journey in post-independent India came from that. Sardar Patel handled it with an iron hand. K.M. Munshi, and of course, you know, there are a number of dimensions to it, that how the communists and the Razakars in Hyderabad were the best of friends, and how the communists also were great friends of the Portuguese in Goa. It's wonderful to speak about the liberation, or at least remember the liberation of Goa, standing here in Karnataka, and Jagannath Rao Joshi's great contribution to that. Again, whitewashed from our history, except some of us speaking about it. So that was the first revolt. The communist challenge was crushed. Communist infiltration within the system, official and academic, was also exposed, but not eliminated. So the first challenge was that, and it was admirably handled by Sardar Patel, we must remember. Next was the propensity for a one-party dominance. Post-December 1950, the composition of Nehru's cabinet was quite different. You had Shyama Prasad Mukherjee, who left the cabinet in April 1950. Very soon you had K.M. Munshi, who was to leave. A number of those leaders, starting from Acharya Kriplani to Acharya Narendra Dev, who formed part of the Congress platform, gradually started moving away. And the Congress party per se, I hope I can be politically incorrect. I hope there's no problem here. The Congress, Nehru's Congress, started whittling down to a party. The challenge posed to Purushottam Das Tandon started whittling down to a party which was controlled by an individual, and gradually started slipping, going down the slippery slope towards dynasticism. So when very articulate out-of-work politicians who keep writing books now say that the base of Indian democracy was laid and protected and preserved by Jawaharlal Nehru, no doubt about it. But we must also remember that in October 1951, one particular political leader decided, no, we should have an alternative political narrative to the Congress, and established the Bharatiya Jana Sangh. And I think it was the establishment of the Bharatiya Jana Sangh in October 1951 with the express intention and objective of A, delineating and evolving policies for India which are in consonance with Indian conditions, thought, tradition, and psyche, and B, to provide a political alternative to the Congress behemoth and hegemony, is actually what ensured that the journey of democracy in India was run on an even keel. It was that formation which ensured that you had a balancing opposition. It was that formation which ensured that you had a broadly cohesive nationalist voice in the first Lok Sabha, which also had a certain political vision of how India post-independence must be evolved. And in that political vision, not only the economic, the industrial, the defense dominated, but in that political vision, the cultural and tradition and the heritage of India also had a key role to play, defined that political narrative. And that's why Shyama Prasad Mukherjee said, Bharatiya, Sanskriti, and Maryada. So this was one aspect. The journey continued. Post-1953, Shyama Prasad Mukherjee's death, Pandit Deendayal Upadhyay took over the reins. And by 1967, the Janasangh had become the largest opposition bloc in the Indian Parliament. So over from 1952 to 67, you had the crystallization, the formation of an alternate political narrative which balanced the Nehruvian consensus. Obviously, the challenge in Kashmir, the fight for the integration of Kashmir, Kashmir turning into an international cockpit for intrigues against India was also a challenge. And of course, through his own physical, through his sacrifice, one thing that Shyama Prasad Mukherjee ensured was that secessionism in India would henceforth never go unchallenged. And I think that was one of the fundamental lessons of his death. And I think that was one of the fundamental messages of the Praja Parishad movement for the greater integration of Jammu and Kashmir with India that percolated down the line through generations. Secessionism, separatism, henceforth never went unchallenged. Of course, we skip and then come down to, I want to also make an observation here, we are working on it. 1951, the debate on the first amendment to the Constitution on freedom of expression. And I think all of you know of it, but I'll reiterate, you'll be surprised to know why Nehru thought at all that restrictions, complete restrictions or restrictions on freedom of expression must be brought in. Because Shyama Prasad Mukherjee advocated Akhand Bharat. And Nehru felt the advocacy, public advocacy of Akhand Bharat would be detrimental to our relation with Pakistan. And Nehru argued since Akhand Bharat at this point of time could only be achieved through military intervention in Pakistan, this is as good as advocating war with Pakistan, and therefore we have to bring in restriction of expression, free speech. So it's a very interesting situation. February 2016, and again, I apologize, I don't want to turn this, but these are essential intellectual discussions that we need to have. February 2016, Nehru's great-grandson jumps across the barrier and stands with those who advocate India's dismemberment. May 1951, Jawaharlal Nehru wants to bring in, and they say, and he says that May, in February 2016, he says that that is freedom of expression. And in May 1951, Jawaharlal Nehru wants to bring in amendment to the Constitution, restriction of freedom of expression. Why? Because you can't say Akhand Bharat. So, who opposed him? Shyama Prasad Mukherjee. And obviously, they were in a minority. So, the issue was passed. But it stopped at reasonable restrictions on freedom of expression. So, the great Democrat, the great constitutionalist, wanted to clamp down on freedom of expression. And freedom of expression for what? For advocating Akhand Bharat. So in any case, what I'm saying is that, coming back to the 1960s and 70s, the rise of the left, of communist parties in Indian politics, the control of Indian academia by left, by the left and leftist thinkers, and the generation of a political narrative which saw a large number of, not, if not a large number of, but a vocal, articulate section of the Indian intellectual, of the elite Indian intellectual, generating a discourse that is based on self-alienation, self-repudiation of all your traditions, self-alienation from your cultural roots. And one obviously cannot exempt the Nehruvian framework from it, because broadly, throughout the early years of post-independence, you had a dominant political narrative which was not very concerned about how we rediscovered ourselves culturally, which never really encouraged that cultural rediscovery of ourselves. And that is why you never had a reorganization of Indian universities. The Indian universities continued to function under the company model of universities. You never really nurtured educational institutions that grew out of your struggle for freedom. You never encouraged the learning and the patronization, the patronage of Indian languages. So one cannot exempt those years, but it was in the late 60s and 70s that the dominance of the left started in Indian politics and in the Indian academia. And that is when you had this entire genre of historians, of cultural analysts, who based their entire educational and political argument on deconstructing Indian society, on deconstructing Bharatiya society. So they looked at everything as deconstructionism. Even the approach to Sabarimala today, even their approach to Sabarimala today is based on that spirit of deconstructionism. Because all that they read was Eric Hobsbawm, E.H. Carr, and all the framework that communist historians or left historians in the West taught, those were imported to Indian conditions, and Indian society, Indian traditions were attempted to be fitted into those Western framework of studying societies. And of course, there was a long line of historians who were groomed, and then, as very beautifully said, you scratch my back, I scratch yours. And then it went on. The next challenge to Indian democracy, you see, what I'm doing is I'm just touching the tip of some of these challenges. The growth of crony capitalism in the late 60s and 70s, when there was a lot of churning and splits in the so-called Congress which spearheaded the freedom movement, that 69, for all practical purposes, that great Congress started in 1885, ceased to exist. 70s, you had the growth of crony capitalism, where perhaps an accountant could be called up and said in a particular branch in the State Bank of India that the Prime Minister requires this much amount of money, so please get it delivered. These were signs of crony capitalism. Of course, in the previous decades, you had the Mundra and the Jeep scandals also. And then in 1975, the greatest and the most acute challenge to Indian democracy came in the form of emergency, suspension of all fundamental rights, imprisoning anyone who differed with the current political dispensation. It was a height of intolerance and clampdown on dissent. Democratic and free India never saw such a thing, and rest assured we'll never see also such a thing. But that was a challenge in the journey of Indian democracy. Post-1980, the rise of dynastism in the political journey of India, political formations which did not grow out of a certain movement, political formations which were not based on a political ideology, na vichar, na vichardhara, political formations which became gatherings or mariage de convenance, centering around a certain political This is the fragmentation. Aspiration legitimate and their legitimate right to fulfill themselves. But on the other hand, many of these regional parties often degenerated into dynastic conglomeration. Degenerated. That was not perhaps their founding ideal. Then, of course, this continued. Sushanji, you please tell me when I need to stop. Is it time? Another 5 minutes? Yeah. So this continued till 2014. And I think in 2014, for 2014 is a watershed, because it is the reiteration, A, that Indian democracies, the journey of democracy in India can often take very interesting turns. It was the reiteration of the consciousness of the voter, of the electorate, of the people of India to rise above cronyism, to rise above dynastism, and to rise above the politics of vote bank, which had become entrenched and established since the 1950s, which had increasingly become entrenched since the 1950s. Well, I'll not get into again analyzing what that mandate meant. But now I'd like to just end with a few observations. One is, post-2014, in the journey of India's democracy, the power of response has increased. The ability to generate a counter narrative has increased. Those who did not have a voice or who did not have a forum found a voice and put together forums. And that is increasingly being seen to pick up more steam and force. The counter narrative or the response cannot be dismissed easily anymore. If you try and give a response, you can be easily dismissed by some as a troll. That is a different matter. The new fashion is to dismiss you as a troll. But be sure that those who are dismissing you as a troll are being compelled to recognize your response. So sensitivity to tradition, responsiveness in protection of tradition, responsiveness and counter narrative on trying to explain who we are culturally and civilizationally has acquired also more political space. And that is also essential for the democracy, the journey of democracy in India. But there's a danger. The danger is, when mainstream political parties or certain political formations pander to subversion or pander to separatism, that should make us think. That should really make us ponder. And in the coming days, in the garb of false narratives, there'll be a lot of pandering to subversion, pandering to separatism and fissiparous tendencies. So friends, I just want to end with this. In fact, what is the challenge, what is the fundamental challenge in India's democratic journey today? And these are not my words. I would like to quote, as I'm quite fond of quoting often, Sri Ramaswarup. Ramaswarup ji defined the politics of self-alienation, and he said, it is the struggle between the politics of self-alienation and the politics of service. Who are those who practice the politics of self-alienation? It is those for whom their country's culture, they have a hatred for their country's culture. And what is this politics of self-alienation? This politics appeals, I would just like you to listen to this definition. This politics appeals in the name of science and rationality, but it is dogmatic and sloganized. It proclaims its love for the poor, but in loving their unfortunate brothers, its votaries give up no privileges. It uses secular and radical phraseology, but it is built on contempt of the masses. Its secularism is anti-religious in general and anti-Hindu in particular. Not only are the secularists allergic to Hinduism, they are even angry with those who do not share their hatred of their country's culture and its past. This is, he defines, as politics of self-alienation. And what does the politics of self-alienation does? It stirs up regional and communal differences and uses minorities in order to perpetuate a party or dynastic rule, or to set up a dictatorship of one kind or another. Opposed to politics of service. The politics of service is different from the politics of power. It requires the capacity to see in common people, even in midst of their poverty, a new dignity and beauty, new qualities of the mind and the heart. I think one can keep defining it, but the essential challenge is how we address this tussle, this struggle between the politics of self-alienation and the politics of service. Post-2014, this struggle has become more acute. And in the years ahead, our actions and our intellectual outreach is actually going to define whether it's the politics of service or the politics of self-alienation which dominates. And it is on that will depend the democratic journey of independent India. Thank you so much, and I'm extremely sorry for having taken so much.